Gwe Akib Jilidak. Hello and welcome to the beautiful Pictou County Wellness Center here in Pictou County, Nova Scotia. For the final time, we say that today. Eight games here on the Sobeys Ice Surface at the Wellness Center for the 2023 Pictou County Bantam Memorial Hockey Tournament. This, the final one of the day in the AA division between the Cape Breton West Islanders, Dartmouth Whalers. Whalers are the home team in their Sweden jerseys. The yellow with the blue. Cape Breton West Islanders in black with the gold, or sorry, gold, not gold, gray on the sleeves. Dartmouth are the home team for this game. Cape Breton West are the visitors. For the Whalers, it's Conrad Eisner in goal. For Cape Breton West, it is Leo Ferrance. And if I'm mispronouncing that, please do send me a correction through Twitter at PetterPC underscore sports. That's at PETTERPC underscore sports. And quickly before the puck drop, we acknowledge that the Pictou County Wellness Center, the entirety of Pictou County and the entire region covered by all the teams within this tournament, which is the entire province of Nova Scotia, all lie within ancestral unceded Mi'kmaq territory. And we are underway here at the Pictou County Wellness Center. Again, this a game in the AA division of the 2023 Pictou County Bantam Memorial Hockey Tournament. And the Islanders with the puck in their own zone. Pass a little bit too far in front of the intended target. That was Hebb that it was intended for, but the pass a little bit beyond him. But now bringing the puck in is a chance for Delaney. And we're going to get our first penalty of the game just a few seconds in. 35 seconds is all it takes for the Dartmouth Whalers to take a slashing penalty. As we take a little bit closer look at this matchup for Cape Breton West. This, their second game of the day. They won 4-2 earlier against Northside. And for Dartmouth, they also coming off of a victory earlier today against Strait Richmond. So both of these teams looking to go a perfect 2-0 on the opening day of the tournament. The penalty taken by the Whalers, Maddox Seabold, 2 minutes for slashing at 35 seconds. Here's McDonald with the puck. He'll play it over to, trying to see a number there. No numbers on the sleeves for the Islanders, so that'll make it a little bit more challenging as Tobin able to get the puck and clear it down the length of the ice. Again, just 35 seconds in was the penalty there taken by Seabold for slashing. As there we are. Islanders look to push the puck ahead. And again, without being able to see the numbers, it's hard to identify who is who for Cape Breton West. Evers has it behind the net, gets it out in front, they score! So Cape Breton West able to take advantage of a power play in the opening moments of this game. And just like that, it only takes a minute and 31 seconds. Sorry, there we go. So the Cape Breton West Islanders quickly out in front, a minute and 31 seconds into the game. Now what is the... As there appears to be some sort of an issue with Leo Ferrance, that means Doucette has to go in. Don't know what the issue is with Ferrance, why he got sent to the bench. Will McLennan gets credit for the power play goal. Avery Evers with the assist on that goal at 1:31. And again, Doucette, Mason Doucette now in the game for the Islanders. After just a minute and 31 seconds, Ferrance had to come out of the game. Something the referee came over to the Cape Breton West bench and told them they had to take Ferrance out. I'm hoping we can get some clarification from somebody as to why. Meanwhile, Brownrigg has the puck down in the corner for the Whalers inside the Cape Breton West zone. Pass Morrissey. His shot goes wide. And with this being the second game of the day for both of these teams, I'm going to presume that Doucette played the game earlier today with the intent being each of them gets one game on the day. Now here comes Morrissey. Morrissey with a burst of speed coming in. Morrissey with a shot. He scores! And now we're going to get a goaltender change back. So whatever the issue was with Ferrance, they've been able to fix it. And he can go back in, but not before Dartmouth ties up the game at a goal apiece. This goal coming at 3:06. Okay. I think the issue, if I read the referee's lips right, he came too close to the bench. So the goal for Dartmouth, Dane Morrissey, assisted by Matthew Ferguson. And if I read the referee's lips correctly, the issue was that Ferrance came too far out of his crease during the goal celebration, so he had to come off for a line change, for a change, because he got too close to the bench. So they had to change him, and then they had to put Doucette in until the next whistle. And then the next whistle was when Dartmouth scored. So lesson learned, if you're the goalie, don't come too far out of your net to join the goal celebration. Because I read the ref's lips and I heard him say he can go to the top of the circle. So he obviously went beyond that and then had to come out for a line change. And now Doucette makes the save. Second chance. Ferrance makes the save. And then the second chance opportunity in Sam LaBelle. And there are a couple of AP players out there whose names I don't have. So anyone from Dartmouth who is watching can send me the names of number 14 and number 15. Or sorry, 15 and 16. 15 and 16 who are not on the roster that I have. If anybody from Dartmouth is watching, send me those players' names, please, through Twitter, at Petter, P-E-T-T-E-R, P-C underscore spot, sports. Okay, well, fortunately, they both just got assists on that goal, and it sounded like he said Ethan Smith is 15 and Chad Ross is 16. So Sam LaBelle with the goal, Ethan Smith and Chad Ross with the assists. If those names are incorrect, please do let me know. And now there's an incredible save by Eisner. As we've had a little bit of everything here in this game already, and we've only played 5 minutes and 15 seconds. Campbell stepping in for the Islanders, loses the puck along the wall, and now coming out, here comes Morrissey. Morrissey cutting to the outside, stops, tries to get a shot away. He gets tied up by Donald Gillis. Now around to the near side. Puck played ahead to McDonald. And, okay, that's a 19. To the Cape Breton West Islanders organization, when it becomes time to replace these jerseys, I'm going to ask two things on behalf of play-by-play guys everywhere. One, numbers on sleeves. Two, a little more contrast on the numbers, please. Dark numbers on a dark background. Very hard to see there. And without numbers on sleeves, it becomes even more difficult. For the Dartmouth Whalers jerseys, I love the numbers being up on the shoulder. That makes them real easy to see. Kenny gets the puck across all the way to the far side. Coming in to get on it is Mahoney. Throws it towards the net. It's steered away. Now Jack McInnes, I believe that was, behind the net. Puck comes to the front of the net. McInnes Kenny trying to find it in his feet. He can't. Now getting the puck is Tobin. He has it knocked off his stick. Goes to the far point, and a little bit of a miscue there by, was that Ferguson? Yes, it was. But Ferguson able to recover enough. And now here's a steal by Ross. Ross coming in, and a big save made there by Ferrance to keep his team within one. Ross gets it up to LaBelle. He plays it back to the line intended for Siebold, but it gets beyond him. Follow the bouncing puck. It's picked up. Okay, Kay's Ross. 15 is Kay's Ross? Cade. Okay. C-A-Y-D. Okay, there we go. Ethan Smith. Okay, there we go. Thank you. Tobin Crew sending it to me on Twitter, and whoever sent it to one of the Dartmouth parents who came up to confirm it as well. So Cade Ross and Ethan Smith. All right. We're good now. Swinging and somewhat missing on that was Donald Gillis. Now here's LaBelle. Gets the puck knocked off his stick right around the blue line, and then puck ends up coming back out to center anyway. Picked up there by, I think that's Aiden McDonald. He plays it over to Ellis. Ellis across to the far side for Jack. No, that's not 12. That's 12. Or that's not 2. That's 12. Gillis. Delaney now. He'll fire a shot from long range. That goes wide. Puck comes up the wall. Is that McClellan? Hard to tell if that's a 2 or a 3. Part of the jersey tucked in at the back. But now Morrissey coming out. He'll get it over to Provo. Provo dumps it in. And I hate to be, you know, that negative guy, but with the dark number on a dark background, it is very hard. And again, without sleeve numbers to double check it against, you get the jersey tucked in a bit at the back. You get, like there's one out there right now. I cannot for the life of me tell if that's a 2 or a 3. And there is a 2 and a 3 on the roster. So I think that's McClellan out there right now for Cape Breton West. Actually, now I can see it a little bit better because he ended up being close enough to me and leaned forward that the bottom part of the number was visible even though it was tucked in. There's a shot taken by Kenny. And getting a piece of it there is Ferenc. Now another shot. That goes wide. Puck gets to the line. Held in at the point there by Carew. Now it goes around to the near side corner. 5:43 to go here in the first period. Back in behind the net. McInnes. That being John Hugh McInnes. There's two McInneses. Two McDonalds. There's a chance in front. And Kenny ends up putting that one into the end glass. I think that was Gillis, and now the puck cleared out to center. LaBelle with it. LaBelle coming through neutral ice. Gets around Evers. Evers, though, stays right with him and is able to chop the puck away. Now it gets picked up by, I believe that's Jack McInnes. That's Ross dumping it down. Cade Ross dumps it into the Cape Breton West zone. Picking up the puck there, Donald Gillis for the Islanders. He loses it to LaBelle as they battle in the corner. Thrown off the side of the net by Ethan Smith. And now the Islanders get the puck, and they'll get out to center. Back to get it is Siebold. Siebold plays it up as far as Hillier. But then Hillier played it back down into the Dartmouth end. Seabold brings it out, plays it off the boards down the ice. And the Islanders back to pick up in their own zone. Gathering it up there, Hillier can't clear. Now the puck gets to the line, held in by Link. Link plays it down into the corner. Sharp angle shot, save made by Ferrance. And he'll hang on for a faceoff, 354, excuse me, left to go here in the third period. In to take the draw. It's going to be Aiden McDonald taking the faceoff against. Now, not quite sure. There was a conversation between the linesman and the Cape Breton West bench. Now they're looking at whether one of the Cape Breton West Islanders' masks was too loose. Brownrigg taking the draw against Aiden McDonald. Puck comes around to the near side. Brownrigg battling in the corner there against Ellis and Aiden McDonald. Link gets it to Brownrigg. Brownrigg takes it behind the net for Dartmouth. Brownrigg trying to create some space. And the Islanders create a turnover. Puck comes as far as the line. Link kind of fans on that shot. And now the Islanders come out. Delaney gets the puck all the way in off the end boards. 3:17 to go, first period. Dartmouth leading it 2-1. Puck fired around by Morrissey over to the near side. It'll be picked up there by Provo. He gets met immediately. And the puck is batted out to center. Going back to get it is John Hugh McInnes. McInnes trying to get away from the forecheck of Morrissey. Morrissey lost his stick for a moment. Puck just stays onside. Now it goes down low. Is that a 19? Campbell? I think so. Puck comes out. Mahoney sends it right back in again. 2:40 to go first period. Meanwhile, next door, they're into the third period. About 3.5 minutes remaining. And it is the Bedford Blue leading the Cape Breton West Islanders in the double or in the single A category. Cape Breton trailing now 4-1 with 3:14 to go as Bedford Blue team just scored again. Attempted wraparound there by Kenny. And making the save is Ferrance, and he'll hang on. 2:08 left to go in the first period. Cape Breton West with a bit of an odd schedule as they played two games today, relatively close together, as they played a 4:30 game and an 8:30 game, and then they won't play until 7 o'clock tomorrow night over on the other sheet of ice. Coming in, there's a shot. The shot taken by Nathan Crichton, and a nice save made there by Conrad Eisner. For Dartmouth, they had a 12 o'clock game earlier today, now playing in this one, and then they won't be back on the ice. They'll be back on the ice at 1 o'clock tomorrow. They'll also be over on Bell Arena for their game tomorrow. So for both of these teams, tomorrow's game will not be streamed, as we only are able to stream from the one sheet of ice. But if either of them make it to the semifinals, depending on which sheet of ice they're on for the semifinals or the final, finals will definitely be available through AO Live, Petter Sports and Streaming Services. And one semifinal in the AA, one semifinal in the A division will be on this sheet of ice as well. Now here comes a chance for Ross. Ross coming in with a partial breakaway, takes a shot, and a big save made there by Ferrance to keep it a 2-1 game. Now another shot. That ends up getting blocked by Jonah Ellis. Now Cape Breton West come back out the other way. That shot goes into the corner. Seabold gets to it first for Dartmouth. He plays it ahead, and here comes Ross again. Cade Ross gets taken into the sidewall by John Hugh McInnes. Now over to the far side, picked up there by Donald Gillis. He'll play it ahead. Islanders not able to clear, though, as Ferguson holds it in. Now McInnes, again, that's John Hugh McInnes, not to be confused with Jack McInnes, who's also out there on the ice right now. Puck comes to the far wall. Evers trying to get on it. He can't, but it's still John Hugh McInnes who plays it ahead for McClellan. There's Jack McInnes. He had it momentarily, but now it's Gillis with it again. And Gillis tries to flip it out, but it ends up going over the glass and out of play, so we'll get a stoppage with 23.8 seconds left to go here in the first period. Dartmouth leading it by a score of 2-1. Down to a minute and 11 left to go, and now it's 4-2 as Cape Breton West has gotten one back. Bedford Blues, blue team in the A division, still leading, though, by a pair of goals into the final minute of that game. Meanwhile, here we got 12 seconds left in the first period. They battle for the puck in the corner. Trying to work it free are the Whalers. And that will just about run. It does run us out of time for the end of the first period. Shots on goal favor Dartmouth in that opening period by a margin of 13-6. And a total of 3 goals altogether, 2 of them for Dartmouth, 1 of them for the Cape Breton West Islanders, means we end the first period with the Whalers out in front by a 2-1 margin. We'll take, and now there's been another goal scored next door. Bedford with another one, making it 5-2 into the final 30 seconds there now. So a 5-2 scoreline. It looks like the Bedford Blues blue team will advance to 1-1. Cape Breton West Islanders will drop to 0-2. Meanwhile here, you've got two teams, both with victories earlier today, both looking to go to 2-0 so far on the tournament. Here comes Brownrigg right off of the draw, gets the puck into the Cape Breton West zone. He'll get turned away. Puck goes to Curran for the Whalers. He'll play it up to Morrissey. Morrissey now gets it to Brownrigg. Brownrigg will dump it in. Off the end boards, picked up there by Ellis. He'll play it ahead. And out come the Islanders. Here's Davidson. His pass goes off a skate. It ends up on the stick of Brownrigg. Brownrigg makes a move to get away from one person, but coming back on the back check was Davidson, and he's able to get possession for the Islanders. His pass across the far side for McKinnon. Just the one McKinnon on the roster there. Yeah. No. Yep. So now with it is Carew. Carew ends up losing it. Davidson will get possession. He goes to make a pass. It does connect with McKinnon. McKinnon, though, trying to get it to Jack McInnes. That doesn't work. And now Brownrigg coming the other way. He'll fire a shot right on to goaltender Leo Ferrance. And Ferrance will hang on for a faceoff with 106 gone here in the second period. They're down to the final 4.8 seconds next door. Still 5-2. And just waiting to see if any other changes come onto the scoreboard in that one, because, of course, goal differential can be a tiebreaker if it gets needed. Puck goes down into the corner. One more game still to start over on the other sheet of ice. That'll be Bedford White against South Shore in the A division. And that one scheduled to get started in about 7 minutes. As the final horn does sound over there. Meanwhile here, we're almost 2 minutes into the second period. K. Cape Breton West Islanders trailing the Dartmouth Whalers 2-1 here in the AA division of this tournament, which, of course, is in memory of three players and a mom who were all killed in a motor vehicle accident in 1984 on their way home from a hockey tournament in New Brunswick. John Allen McDonald, Donald Gladwin, Sean McKay, and Lee Marie McKay, who was, of course, Sean's mom, all perishing in that fatal accident 39 years ago this month. And, of course, earlier this evening we had the opening ceremonies where we had members of the McKay, McDonald, and Gladwin families all here to participate in that. And some of their teammates from that 83-84 season as well. The first tournament was held in 1985 and has been held every year since, of course, with the exception of 2021 and 22 because of COVID. But now here in 2023, we're able to get it back going again. And we're so thrilled to be able to honor the memories of those three players. And, of course, Lee Marie McKay as well. So Bedford with the 5-2 victory over the Cape Breton West A team. The AA team here in a tough battle with Dartmouth in the second period. LaBelle pokes the puck down, centering pass, gets broken up. Carew now will send it down for Ross. Ross trying to get it to the front of the net. He gets a bump from, I think that was Hillier. And the Islanders able to get possession, and out they come. Puck played ahead to Evers. He'll just dump it the rest of the way down the ice, and he'll head off for a change. Getting it for Dartmouth is York. He'll play it ahead for Ross. And Ross will dump it down the ice off the end boards. Gathered up by Ferrance, who set it up for his defenseman. That was Ellis. Now the puck comes ahead to Davidson. He'll pick up and go across to McKinnon. McKinnon has it knocked off his stick. Provo picks up, and Davidson looks like he got caught in the side of the head with something. Didn't quite see what came up and caught him, but whatever it was, he was holding the side of his head there. Delaney gets it ahead for McKinnon. McKinnon trying to work his way around Seabold. Seabold gets his stick on the puck, however, and the Islanders back into their own zone. Delaney, another pass intercepted by Provo this time, and Morrissey will get it down into the Cape Breton West zone. Back to pick up is John Hugh McInnes with 4.5 minutes gone here in the second period. Provo out from below the goal line, tries to stuff it in short side. Save made by Ferrance. Now coming up the wall to Ferguson. He sends it back down the boards into the corner. Ellis will get it around to the far side. McInnes, John Hugh, able to pick up there. Plays it forward for, is that Campbell or is it Hebb? Can't tell if that's a 19 or an 18. Puck passed to McDonald. He can't get a shot away, that being Aiden McDonald. And now Dartmouth coming out the other way. Puck batted away by Hebb. Is that an 18? I can't tell what's an 18 and what's a 19 on those jerseys. There's a shot by one of the two. Okay. The defenseman is Campbell. The forward is Hebb. Oh, my gosh. I'm really sorry, folks. Cape Breton West fans, I am not trying to get players wrong. I'm really not. I am genuinely having trouble seeing dark numbers on a dark jersey, especially with the font of those numbers making it very hard to tell a difference between an 18 and a 19 and a 2 and a 3 when they're tucked into the back of the jersey. And I am very sorry. I am trying really hard. Gillis has the puck now. He'll bring it ahead. Gets a backhander. Gets to Evers. Evers puts it just wide of the net. Now we're going to get a penalty against Dartmouth. With 9:12 left to go here in the second period. And The penalty to Dartmouth. Hooking is the indication, and it's Link who's going to go off. So the Islanders will get their second power play of the game. They converted on their first power play. But Dartmouth off to a good start on this kill as they're able to launch the puck down the length of the ice. Penalty being called at 5:48, excuse me, of the second period. Now with the puck, that is Will McClellan. McClellan gets taken off of the puck. And it's once again launched the length of the ice. Lead pass a little bit too far out of the reach of the intended target, and so that's going to be an icing call against Cape Breton West, and they'll have to go back deep into their own zone to get the puck, or to have a face-off with 8:36 left to go, second period, 1:24 remaining in the power play for Cape Breton West. Puck goes off the skate of Gillis. Morrissey, he can't get in and get a shot away. Seabold tries to play it ahead. It goes to Delaney now. And Delaney will get it over to Davidson. Davidson in across the blue line. Has the puck knocked away from him. Comes all the way up the boards and out to center. Bringing it ahead now is Brownrigg. Brownrigg all the way in, gets a shot away. And making the save is Ferrance, and he'll hang on for a faceoff. Two points. All right. Islanders make a late change just before the puck drop, and so that means they'll... McDonald comes in to take the draw. And Gillis brings the puck ahead, gets it across to the far side for Aiden McDonald. McDonald takes it all the way down below the goal line, throws it towards the front of the net. Dartmouth able to get possession, though, and they'll clear it away from danger. 30 seconds left in the penalty. Aiden McDonald comes back, picks up the puck, being watched by Mahoney. And now Seabold will fire it back down into the Cape Breton West zone. Gillis off the end boards. Ellis back to Gillis. Now to Delaney. Delaney goes cross ice with that one. And the Islanders able to bring the puck in. Pass for Delaney. Takes it down to the corner. The stick of Curran was flipped way up into the air. Don't know how that wasn't an interference call, but it wasn't. And now... a save made by Eisner, and he'll hang on for a faceoff. 7:03 left to go here in the second period. Crichton in to take the draw. Crichton gets it back again, tries to get a shot away but gets tripped up, so we're going to get another penalty against Dartmouth. One penalty expires, and 15 seconds later, they go shorthanded again. You got to figure the Cape Breton West Island. Well, the Islanders have scored once on the power play, and Link, who just got back on the ice after the hooking call, goes right back into the penalty box for tripping. At 8:07 of the second period, Creighton gets waved out of the faceoff circle. Coming in to take the draw instead is Will McLennan. And Dartmouth once again able to launch the puck down the length of the ice. Going back to get it there. Okay, that's Campbell because he's the defenseman. He gets it ahead to Evers. Evers plays it forward for Creighton. Crichton taking it all the way back into his own zone. He'll play it across the far side. Then a pass for Evers. Evers gets it ahead to McClellan, but McClellan ends up bringing the puck in offside with 6:21 left to go in the second period. 1:28 left to go in this, the third power play of the game for the Cape Breton West Islanders. Crichton to take this draw against Kenny. Kenny wins it, and Dartmouth get the puck down as far as the Cape Breton West blue line. John Hugh McInnes gets it ahead. It gets beyond Evers. The attempted dump out was knocked down in neutral ice. Now it's back down into the Islander zone. McInnes overskates the puck but is able to recover, gets it back, plays it ahead for Evers. He lets it go to Crichton. Crichton in across the line. And Dartmouth, that's Ross, able to launch it down the ice yet again. Back with it. I think that's Hillier behind the net with it. Yes, it is. He'll get it over to Delaney. His pass intended for Gillis. Gillis now gets it ahead to Hebb. But Hebb coughs it up, and Dartmouth send it back down the ice again. Just 20 seconds left in the power play. Delaney, meanwhile, blows a tire as it looked like Gillis was getting ready to make the pass to him, but Gillis wisely held on to the puck. Now over to the near side. Delaney will get to it. He'll chop it the rest of the way down as we're back to 5-on-5. Under 5 minutes to go here in the second period. LaBelle tries to pitch fork it out to center. He does get it ahead. Picked up by Smith. Smith coming in, gives to Ross, but that pass just a little bit behind Ross. Ross chases it down at the far side. McDonald gets to it for Cape Breton West. Now a pass over to Ross near side. He fires a Smith near side, rather. And he fires a shot that goes wide. Didn't get much on that. It went off the heel of his stick, perhaps. Now out in center ice, there's Davidson. He loses control of the puck. McDonald will pick it up and start to work his way ahead. 4:09 left to go here, second period. We are back at 5-on-5. Provo lost the puck into his own feet there for a moment, was able to find it, gets it into the Cape Breton West zone, where the Islanders start moving ahead. McInnes finds Davidson. Davidson sends a shot on net. That gets steered away. Scramble in front. They score! Ryan Davidson. Davidson able to fire that one in. And we're all tied up at two goals apiece with 3:41 left to go here in the second period. So the Islanders score first. They take the 1-0 lead. Dartmouth responds with two in a row. And then the Islanders strike again to tie up this game here at 11:19 of the second period. Confirming Davidson gets the goal indeed. Brady McKinnon with the lone assist on that one. So it is Ryan Davidson from Brady McKinnon at 11:19 to make it now a 2-2 tie. Tobin coming into the Islander end. He fires that one off the end boards. Tobin goes in after it himself, gets to it there, plays it behind the net for Mahoney. Mahoney tries to get it out front. It ends up going just out of the reach of Link and out to center. Now Link will play it back across to Ferguson. Ferguson tries to play it ahead, but ends up putting it into the Cape Breton West bench. And so we'll get a stoppage with 2:43 remaining here in the second period, of this tie game. They're just about to drop the puck next door for the game between the Bedford Blues White team and South Shore. Bedford winning their game earlier today against the Cape Breton West Islanders A team, while South Shore ended their game with a victory as well. So both of those teams 1-0 as they're about to get started over on Bell Arena. And again, that game That game will not be a final by the time we wrap up for the day. But we'll update you on that tomorrow. And I believe if you go to the tournament's Facebook page, I think they're updating scores as well. So you might want to be able to, you might want to check it out there. Here's Ferguson with the puck at the line. He fires a shot, save, rebound, another chance. Puck still loose. And now finding it and hanging on is Ferrance with 2:22 left to go here in the second period. Face-off will be off to the right of Ferrance. Islanders get possession off of the draw. Not able to clear the zone, however, as LaBelle gets it back in deep. Puck comes to the near side corner. Gillis goes around behind his own net. He'll play it ahead. Now down into the corner. York sends it around towards the near side. Islanders able to pick up there, and out they come. Evers tries to use the boards to work his way around Ferguson. Does get the puck in deep, but back to get it is York. And York will work his way ahead. 1:42 left to go here, second period. York gains the red line, dumps the puck in. Comes all the way around to the near side corner. Gillis there. He'll take a bump from Ross, or from Smith, excuse me. Ross also in there forechecking. Now the puck ends up with Delaney. Delaney working his way out. Delaney still with the puck. Now loses it to Morrissey. Carew gets it to Morrissey, and Morrissey will come out. Here comes Morrissey. He's got Brownrigg with him. Morrissey with a shot. Blocker save made by Ferrance. Now down into the corner. Brownrigg lost it in his own feet. Puck played to the boards again. Provo gets it to Brownrigg. Brownrigg with a shot. That goes into the end glass. Puck comes up to Carew. Carew can't get it before Delaney knocks it past him. Here comes Delaney. He's got a man coming with him. Delaney with a shot. And getting a piece of it was Eisner. And it deflects up over the glass. Now to play, we'll get a stoppage with 45.4 seconds left to go here in period number two. We'll get a full intermission here between periods two and three. So we'll get the full flood in the whole nine yards. And then one more 15-minute period before we are done for the day. Puck rolls in onto Eisner. He'll cover up again. 41.3 seconds left now. As we get set up again, McDonald taking the draw against, who was that? That was Kenny who took the draw. McDonald, that being Aiden McDonald. Heath McDonald, I don't think, is actually here at this game, as I haven't called his name yet. I don't think I've seen him here, so we're going to stop worrying about identifying McDonald. And there we go. That's 10.8 seconds left now in here in the second period. Score 2-2. Delaney with the puck, throws it towards the net. There's a deflection off the stick of Hebb, but he puts it just wide of the target. As the time runs out, shots on goal in the second period, 10-9 in favor of Cape Breton West. Two-period total still favors Dartmouth, 22-16. And at the end of two periods of play, we're all tied up at two goals apiece, just the one goal in that second period by Cape Breton West to tie it up. So we will go to the third with everything still to be determined in this one. Both teams looking to go to a 2-0 record as they both won earlier today. You are watching the 2023 Pictou County Bantam Memorial Hockey Tournament here on Petter Sports and Streaming Services through AO Live. Welcome back as we get ready for the start of the third period here between the Dartmouth Whalers and the Cape Breton West Islanders. And I just want to send a big thank you out to everybody who's been sending kind words about the broadcast. I really do appreciate hearing from everybody who does appreciate the work that we're doing here with Better Sports and streaming on AO Live. So honored to be a part of this tournament with the significance of this tournament in this community. I mean, I wasn't living here back in 1984 when the tragedy occurred, but having lived here for the last 17 years, I know how important this tournament has been since it started back in 1985 to honor the memories of John Allen McDonald, Donald Gladwin, Sean McKay, and Lee Marie McKay. So to be able to do my part to help with the honoring of their memories in this tournament every year, it means a lot to me individually, means a lot to my family that I get to be here and be a part of this. As my wife did grow up in Pictou County, she was living here in 1984. And there, right off, there's a shot. And she knows how important this tournament is. There's Provo with a chance going the other way. And 21 seconds into the period, just like that, a glorious chance at one end for Cape Breton West, a great chance at the other end for Dartmouth. And it's still 2-2. Thanks to Leo Ferrance at one end and Conrad Eisner at the other. Now Brownrigg waved out of the faceoff circle. Provo will come in to take the draw instead. McDonald wins the faceoff, but Brownrigg hustles to get onto that puck, tries a wraparound. It ends up going off the side of the net. Now McDonald will take it out from behind the net, play it off the boards to the line and out. It's sent back in, delayed offside, brought back out of the zone. Now Link dumps it in again, and that's going to be an icing as Link was on his own side of center. And so we'll get the icing call with just 40 seconds gone here in the third period. As we look next door, Bedford White leading South Shore. Again, that's an A-division game. Looking at our broadcast scheduled for tomorrow, we'll have three of our four games will be in this AA division. We'll start off at 9 a.m. with Antigonish taking on the Northside Vikings. And then it's going to be Pictou County, Pictou County, Pictou County. 10:30, the AA Crushers take on Sydney. At 12 o'clock, the single A Crushers take on Bedford White. And then at 1:30, the AA Crushers take on Northside Vikings. And that will wrap up our coverage of the round robin portion. After the 1:30 game, there are going to be two more games on Petter Sports and streaming tomorrow. One of them at the U15 major level, as the Wherewell Bombers will be playing at home tomorrow against the Valley Wildcats. And then we'll have the week's majors of the U18 hosting the Valley Wildcats. So we'll have a couple of Valley Wildcats games at the U15 major and the U18 major level. And there's an offside against the Islanders with a minute 32 gone here in the second period. Or third period, excuse me. And again, those games tomorrow, 4:30 for the Bombers game, 6:30 for the week's game. And that will wrap things up for tomorrow. And then Sunday we're into semifinals and then a week's game and then finals. And what it all amounts to is by the time the weekend is done, you will have watched 19 games of hockey here on Petter Sports and Streaming Services through AO Live. And then I go sleep. And then head to work on Monday in my other job. And again, I want to send, I mentioned this in one of the games earlier today, but I do want to say it again. Huge shout out and a thank you to Pictou Landing First Nation School, who graciously gave me the time off today to be here and broadcast all of these games. I teach part-time at that school, working math resource with the students who need a little bit of extra help sometime, and got the day off today to come down here and talk hockey all day to all of you lovely people. 12:30 left to go here in the third period. This game all tied up at 2 goals apiece. Brown Rig trying to go sharp angle, looking to get it short side, but Leo Ferrance once again able to make the save and hang on. 2:36 now gone here in the third period. And just a quick note about the fact that this game is tied right now. In the event that it stays tied all the way through to the end of regulation, it will stay tied. There is no overtime or shootout or anything along those lines in the round robin portion of the tournament. Once we get to the semifinals and the finals, there's still no shootout. The way the breaking of a tie goes in a game in either the semifinals or a final, you'll play a 5-minute sudden death 4-on-4, and then you'll go to 3-on-3 until there's a winner. So no shootouts, no skills competitions to determine a winner, but it will be 3-on-3. And again, that's just for the semifinals and the finals on Sunday. Any game in the round robin portion that ends in a tie will stay a tie. We've already had two ties today, both of them on this sheet of ice. Just the way things have worked out, both of the games that have ended in ties have been on this sheet of ice. Both of them have been in the A division as well. Every game in the double A division has ended with a winner one side or the other. Puck cleared down the ice. It's going to be again an icing against Cape Breton West. 11:07 left to go here in the third period. Next door, they've reached the end of the first period, and it is Bedford White, the Blues white team at the A level, leading the South Shore Lumberjacks by a score of 1-0 again. Both of those teams, just like in this game, both teams looking to improve to 2-0 on the tournament so far. As a lot of teams have played two games today, and we'll have one game tomorrow. We'll have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. We'll have six teams out of the 20 who will play two games tomorrow and just had one game today as the puck is again iced. 10:35 left to go here in the third period. Pictou County A team, Pictou County Double A team, one of those teams that will play twice tomorrow. Glace Bay, Northside, all of these at the Double A level. Glace Bay, Northside, Pictou County will all play twice tomorrow, as will Antigonish will play twice tomorrow as well. So those are the four teams on the Double A side who will play two games tomorrow. Turning and firing wildly there was one of the Dartmouth Whalers. I didn't quite catch the number. Puck comes out to center. York there to knock it down. It's right back into the zone. Brownrigg takes a bump. Gets the puck to Morrissey. Morrissey with a shot. That goes just wide. Now held in at the line. Shot gets blocked by Crichton. And York holds it in at the line again. Clearing attempt knocked down by Morrissey. Another nice knocked down by York right at the blue line. Now it's finally cleared out and down the length of the ice. And that will be an icing with 9:34 left to go here in this third period. On the A side tomorrow, it will be Sydney and Chibucto who play twice tomorrow. And again, the tournament format 10 teams in the AA division, 10 teams in the A division. Every team plays three games. So every team plays three games. It's in obviously a very incomplete round robin, and they're not broken up into pools or anything like that. Just everybody plays three games. Top four records advance to the semifinals. Tiebreakers include goal differential. First tiebreaker is better win-loss record, obviously. Second tiebreaker then goes to plus-minus, so goals for minus goals against. Then it goes to the quotient, which is goals for divided by goals against. So let's say two teams are both plus six. The team that has scored more goals will have not as good of a quotient. So the team that, let's say, wins their three games by a combined total of 7-1 would get the tiebreaker ahead of a team that wins their three games by a combined total of 8-2. As Cape Breton West taking a head contact penalty here. So those are the first tiebreakers. Goals or goal differential, then goal quotient, so fewer goals scored overall with the same differential. The penalty taken by Jack McInnes for head contact, and it's the first penalty taken by Cape Breton West here in this evening's game, coming with 8:25 left to go in the third period. If those are the same, then it's fewest penalties taken. Not penalty minutes, but total penalties taken. So if you take a, like in this game, Cape Breton West so far has taken just one penalty. Dartmouth has only taken three, so both of these teams in pretty good stead in that regard. If they're still tied there, then it is the team that scored the earliest goal for their first goal in the tournament. So, in your first game, how quickly did you score your first goal? And if that's still tied, well then, you go to the coin flip. And if the coin ends up landing on its side, well then I don't know what you do there. You just... My grade eight students will tell you about the probability of a coin landing on its side when you flip it. They'll let you know that that is considered an improbable to the point of negligible probability. As the puck cleared down the ice, and the interesting thing is we're actually just working on probabilities right now with my grade eight class. I work with students who have extra needs as the resource math teacher, but I also teach the grade eights their math curriculum as well. Puck fired around by McInnes. That'll go down the length of the ice as the Islanders doing a good job on their penalty kill here so far. Just 17 seconds left to go in the power play. Puck played ahead to Provo. Provo for Brownrigg. That pass, though, gets deflected away. Now it'll be picked up by Link. Here comes Link into the Cape Breton West zone. Link takes it all the way down into the corner. Tries to get a pass out in front. Fans on it. Now does get the pass over. Played back to the line. Shot from the point there. That goes wide off the stick of Curran. And now out come the Islanders. Here comes a chance for McClellan. McClellan gets it across. There's a shot and a save made by Eisner. And he'll hang on for a faceoff. 6:12 left to go here in the third period. Next door, there have been a couple more goals scored. Bedford White still leads it over South Shore, but it's now 2-1, where earlier, last time I looked over, it was 1-0. Bedford White still ahead by a goal, so they've traded goals in the early stages of the second period there. And again, we'll not be able to give you a final score in that one before this game finishes up, obviously, as they're only in the second period there. But we'll... Tomorrow morning, as soon as we come on the air for our first game at 9 o'clock, we'll bring you up to speed. And throughout the games tomorrow involving the Werewell Bombers and the Weeks Majors, We will continue to update you on scores from the Bell Arena as well. So even if we're not broadcasting a game from the tournament, while we are broadcasting here other games that are taking place on this sheet of ice, we will keep you up to date on what's going on in the tournament. So we invite you to tune in to the games between the Valley Wildcats and the Werewell Bombers, and then the Valley Wildcats and the Weeks Majors, as we bring you those games tomorrow. And I'm sorry that tonight that the commentary here in the third period is kind of all over the place. Ross gets the puck there, plays it over to the near boards. York will go down into the corner, get it, takes a bump, gets it out towards the front, and the puck batted away there by Ellis. Now the Islanders looking to clear the zone. Shot from the line by Smith, and it looked like it might have been going wide, but Ferrant's not taking any chances anyway. Now here comes a chance for the Islanders, and getting over to make a play there was Noah York. Not able to clear the zone, however, as Brady McKinnon holds it onside. Puck dumped in right onto Eisner. He sets it up there for York. York ends up turning it over. Now there's a chance for McInnes. His shot goes wide. McKinnon trying to get away from York in behind the net. Gets it out. There's a chance for Davidson. And Conrad Eisner coming up big here in the third period with a couple of saves on some dangerous chances for Cape Breton West. Islanders have only gotten six shots on goal in this period, but the shots that they've had have been dangerous. And that's going to be an icing call against Dartmouth, so the puck will come all the way back with 4:10 remaining here in the third period. They're tied next door now, as it seems like every time I look over, another goal goes up on the board. Bedford White and South Shore in the A division. Tie game at two goals apiece. Almost halfway through the second period there. Morrissey gets the puck ahead. Brownrigg able to poke it out to center. Here comes Brownrigg. He's got Provo with him. Brownrigg to Provo. Provo! And who? I'm not sure what the number was on the back checker there. I think it was number two, Jack McInnes. Coming back, denying Provo from getting a shot away. And now here come the Islanders the other way. Davidson cutting to the outside. Gets a shot off. Save made. Rebound. Another great save by Eisner. And the puck goes rolling into the corner. 3:35 left to go here, third period, still 2-2, as Eisner and Ferrance are putting on a show of fantastic goaltending for you here this evening. Davidson with the puck again. He'll dump it right onto Eisner. Eisner will hold on. Now he'll cover up and get a faceoff. 3:20 left to go here, third period. Wow. If you're a young goaltender at the U9, U11 level, you want to learn how to be a goaltender, watch what these two goalies have done here so far in this game. It has been absolutely phenomenal. Puck comes to the line. Campbell shot gets blocked. Campbell steps up again. He'll pull it down all the way into the corner, then send it behind the net to Delaney. Delaney tries to get it out front. Kenny there to knock that pass away. Held in at the line by Campbell. And now back to get it is Ferguson. Plays it off the boards. Tobin not able to clear as Campbell holds the line. Tobin gets it back again. Now he'll play it out to center. But the Islanders quickly pick up, and here's McDonald with it. He'll bring it right back into the Dartmouth zone. McDonald trying to get to the middle of the ice. Has the puck knocked off his stick by Kenny. But the Islanders continue to pressure here. 2:35 to go, third period. Ferguson in the corner. Works the puck up the wall. Tobin gets it the rest of the way out. It goes down the ice, but it's going to go right on target onto the net, and so it won't be an icing. And covering up the puck is Ferrance, and he'll hang on for a faceoff. 2:23 left to go, third period, tied at two goals apiece. And again, if this game stays tied and we reach zeros on the clock, no overtime, no shootout, a tie remains a tie at the end of regulation. Each team gets 1 point in the standings. Both teams would move to 3 points after getting wins earlier today. Ellis gets the puck into the Dartmouth zone. Picked up there by York. York backs up with it, now gets it across to the far side for LaBelle. LaBelle plays it ahead, intended for Smith. Smith able to pick up at the far wall. Comes to the middle of the ice, takes a shot. Steered away relatively easily by Ferrantz. Puck sent in behind the net, picked up there by Gillis. Gillis trying to get away from the forecheckers. Gillis has his stick tied up, loses control of the puck. LaBelle gets on it, but Gillis able to win it back. Now Smith ties Gillis up at the wall. That allows LaBelle to come and get the loose puck. Tries to get it out in front for Ross, but that pass gets deflected away, comes out to center. Ross on the back check does a great job of stealing the puck back again from McGlellan. Now Smith gets it back in once again. Islanders on the puck below their own goal line. 1:15 to go here. Third period still tied at two. Puck played out to center. Poked ahead. But another great job on the back check by Cade Ross. Ross doing an amazing job in this game on some defensive side of the puck. He's also picked up a point in this game. We're into the final 50 seconds. Morrissey has that puck get by him. McDonald can't get past Provo. Provo not able to maintain control of the puck, but Morrissey will pick it up. His pass for Brownrigg just out of his reach. And that's going to be an icing call against Dartmouth with 36.8 seconds left. And quickly to answer the question that I know a lot of people probably have right now, no, there are no timeouts. So as much as the Cape Breton West Islanders might want to call a timeout right now to talk it over with their players to set something up, there are no timeouts in round robin play. As the tournament rules state, no timeouts during round robin play. I'm sure they will be allowed timeouts for the semifinals and championship game, but here in the round robin, nope, no timeouts. We just play on. 20 seconds left. Getting to the puck here is Davidson. Davidson will get it ahead for McDonald. McDonald coming in, 13 seconds left. Tries to make a pass. It goes off a skate, rolls right in onto Eisner, and Eisner will cover up. And this might be the final face-off of this game. 10.7 seconds left. Shots in this period now. Cape Breton West with 10. The Dartmouth Whalers with 7. The two-period total. Dartmouth Whalers outshoot Cape Breton West 29-26. Both goaltenders have been dynamite. I know I don't pick the players of the game, but if I did, I know they would be certainly my two candidates. And this game will end in a 2-2 tie. And maybe it's fitting that it does end that way, because this has been such an evenly matched game, such a well-played game by both teams, both deserving of a single point out of this one. Stick around for the presentation of the players of the game before we sign off for the day. Again, the final score, our first tie at the AA level here at the 2023 Pictou County Bantam Memorial Tournament. We've had two other ties today, but this is the first one at the AA level. The other two ties were both in the A side of the tournament. And again, I don't pick the players of the game, but I know who my choices would be. And they're both wearing a lot more gear than everybody else. Let's just put it that way. As we wait for that presentation of the players of the game. Aiden McDonald, also a very good choice. I'm not going to take anything away from McDonald. He was a very good choice. Ferrantz might have been my choice, but hey, McDonald, a very good selection as well. Sam LaBelle, who scored the goal that put the Dartmouth Whalers ahead at that point, 2-1. So those are your players of the game. That will do it for us here today. Day number one wraps up here at the Pictou County Wellness Center. 8 fantastic hockey games on this sheet of ice. We got 4 more tomorrow, plus a couple of major games. And then we got, how many more am I doing on Sunday? 4 more tournament games and one other game as well. You're going to get sick of hearing my voice by the end of the weekend. I know that, and I appreciate you being with us for as long as you have been. Until tomorrow morning, bright and early, less than 12 hours from now, this is Michael Petter saying, may your skates always be sharp, may your shots always hit the top shelf. Thanks so much for watching. Enjoy the rest of your Friday night.